Welcome to the class today. Today we will have a lecture that basically we will cover some things we have seen in the past, especially in the computer networks course, for those of you that took the course. And in particular, let's see what is in the agenda for today. Okay. So we will, as you see here, we will have two parts in this lecture today. In the first part, we will see again what is the address resolution protocol, and we will start with a reminder of how addressing at the link layer works. We will follow on, and we will see. Remind ourselves how switches work in computer networks. And we will finish the first part, and we will see how virtual LANs operate, and what specifically, what functions they provide. Okay. Okay, so in the second part, we will move from layer 2 to layer 3. We'll go to the network layer. And in the second part, we will start and we will see again how network address translation works. What are the reasons we have these functions, and also what are the criticisms against network address translation. Second, we will move into routing, and there we will briefly remind ourselves some key concepts about internet routing. Starting from the hierarchical nature of internet routing, why is routing hierarchical in the internet? And also looking into a bit into routing protocols, intra-domain routing protocols, as well as inter-domain routing protocols, border gateway, RIP, and so on. And finally, if time permits, we will see an example that combines all this fundamental understanding in many different protocols about basically how different protocols operate in the internet when we see, when we do something very basic, when very simply we pull a web page from a website. Okay. Good. Sounds interesting? A bit interesting? Okay, great. Okay. So, and of course, we will have an opportunity to exercise our English today. So, if you haven't talked English today, now you have, like, now is your chance. Okay, let me ask you a very, very, very simple question. How many addresses we have in computer networks? How many types of addresses? What?
Physical address and logical address.
Physical address and logical address. Right. What other names?
MAC address.
Yes? Go ahead.
Here is
MAC addresses are physical addresses, correct? And IP addresses are logical addresses. Okay, fantastic. So who can tell me some differences between MAC addresses and IP addresses? Christ first.
Can't change the MAC address.
Right. Okay. So MAC addresses are static, IP addresses are usually dynamic.
By the MAC address, MAC address.
Okay, very good point.
In the world.
Very good
in
point. The world. So MAC addresses carry no semantics about where you are located in the world and in the network more specifically. In other words, if I give you a MAC address of my computer, you don't know if this computer is in New Zealand or is in Crete. On the other side, if I give you an IP address, you have some idea of where this is.
Is this a rule in the addressing system, or is this something that people use? For MAC addresses too?
No.
Or is it in the standard of IP address?
It's in the standard.
It's in the standard.
Yeah, it's basically how IP addresses, it's how routing works actually. So your classmate asks if I got the question correctly. The question in my words is basically what we said before, is this fixed to stone? Is this a rule of the protocol, of the standards, or why is that? And it is a rule of the protocol, and it relates to routing. If you remember, in layer 3, routing is you have the rule of aggregation of blocks of IP addresses, and to make routing more efficient, you have you allocate IP addresses to ISPs, and ISPs allocate prefixes to their customers, and so on. And this allows the aggregation of addresses. At the end of the day, it reduces the size of the routing table. On the other side, MAC addresses are flat. Okay. So we will discuss this also further on. I think it will become more clear today. So other differences, what other differences can we find between MAC address and IP addresses?
When we send a packet, there is a MAC address on it and an IP address, where the IP address refers to the target terminal we want the packet to be sent, where the MAC address is the address of the continuator or router in the that the packet will leave. So the packet will travel until the nearest router, which is the MAC address, and there it will follow another way with another MAC address, where the IP address stays the same in the packet until it reaches the destination. No, if I said it.
Yes, you said it right. You said it right. Cool. Any other different? How many bits we have for MAC addresses?
48 bits.
48 bits? Who agrees? Who doesn't agree? Doesn't remember? The rest of the class. Right? 48 bits. Congratulations. I'm proud. And how many bits we have for IP addresses?
32.
32, of course. Is this a complete answer? And for IPv6? And for IPv6, it's 128. Okay, guys, I think we found the key differences between IP addresses and MAC addresses. Okay. So we have covered everything here. Okay. So now let's switch to a different protocol. Who remembers who can tell me what is the address resolution protocol? Yes?
It is used to find the MAC address when you only know the IP address of a...
Fantastic, bravo. Okay, so... What do you mean? Which IP address of
it?
Let me repeat it. So basically, the address resolution protocol. Basically, it's a fairly simple protocol that allows us to map IP addresses to MAC addresses. So if we know the IP address of a server, for example, we want to communicate, we can use ARP to. Right. I mean, the server can be in the local.
Yes,
it's not incorrect. The server.
Yes, but many people get the idea that when you are for the destination.
True, but the destination.
The destination. If the destination is on the global signal, then this is a special case, but in general.
Yeah, so basically, this is the case I was referring to. Okay, so let me change topic a bit, or maybe I won't change topic. And okay, let's go back to the art. Okay, and let's start with this example. And so for each computer here and for each interface, we have a MAC address and an IP address. Okay, so the address resolution protocol allows us, if we know the IP address of a computer, to learn the MAC address that is associated with this IP address. Now, in this example, basically, the IP addresses are IP addresses of computers that are attached to the LAN, to the same LAN. Basically, what basically the discussion before was is that in the typical case, we won't try to speak to someone that is in the same LAN. We will try to speak to somebody that is in a different LAN, that will be in some other place in the internet. In this case, when we will ARP, we will ARP to find the IP the MAC address of the router that is attached in this LAN. We will see this also in some examples further on. Yes.
And it search about the ARP, and I think the general case is that over three hops, you use the ARP to find the MAC address of the IP you have, and it's a specific case, the one you said, if you are in the same net, you can use ARP to find the next hop, but in general, if you have more than three hops, you use ARP to find.
Okay, I mean, that's not important. I mean, let's not spend too much time on it. Okay, so so basically, each computer has an ARP table, and this ARP table keeps mappings of IP addresses to MAC addresses. Okay, because when we want to write a packet and address it to somebody, of course, we need to have in this packet both the IP addresses and the MAC addresses at layer 3 and at layer 2 accordingly. Okay, an ARP table has entries of these mappings. It's very simple. It's basically one of the mapping functions that are used in a computer network, and it maps IP address to MAC to MAC. In addition, in addition to this tuple IPs and MACs, we also have a time to live that, according to the book, it's typically 20 minutes. The time to live. Okay, any question? No questions? Okay, great. So let me ask a question then, if you don't have any questions. Who can describe me how the ARP protocol works? So assume that we are in this LAN, and we want to send a packet from this computer to that computer. We just boot it. How is the ARP what are the steps of the ARP protocol?
To find the MAC address of this IP address. applications that are on the LAN, they will see all the stations receive this that has this IP address, this port, this MAC address.
Great. Fantastic. So it's a simple process. We just sent so the first step. So A wants to send to B. A broadcast an ARP query. That's the name of the first message, ARP query. The destination MAC, it's the broadcast. It's basically the address you see over here. And all nodes in the LAN will receive the ARP query. Okay. So the ARP query contains the IP address of B. Okay, it's a query for this IP address. And it contains the source address of A, of course. Okay, so B will receive the ARP packet. It will send a reply to A. This is a unicast now reply. It is sent directly. And it will tell A that this is my MAC address. Okay, so then A will put this into the ARP table, will cast the association, and we know, and this is how we learn this association. Yes?
Are there any safety mechanisms?
Any?
Safety mechanisms, like as the author of the interface know if you're there.
Fantastic. Yes. So I understand that there is no safety mechanism in the basic ARP. There is no safety mechanism.
Can I add something more?
Yes, let's have it.
What you can do as an administrator at layer 2 is map MAC addresses to devices. So let's say that you have a LAN with 10 computers and you know each computer, you trust it, and you want to map it to a specific IP and a specific MAC on a specific port. You can do that statically. So if anybody else takes off your computer and plugs in another one, it will not work because it's statically mapped. That's the hard way, because if you have 100 computers, 1,000 computers, it's hard to maintain all this. So what they came up with at layer 2 is what it's called, how should I say it? Called port security for Cisco. Cisco developed that, where they say you are allowed in a specific port to have just one MAC. It doesn't matter which MAC, the first one. If a second one comes in, the port is disabled. Or if you can say that you can have only 3 MACs or 5 MACs, but not more than this. And this option is called sticky. If I answer your question.
That's not self-manageable, right?
It is, because when the port is shut down, you have the monitor tells you as an administrator that this port is shut down, something's wrong there. Actually,
you have to have an administrator.
You have to have an administrator, for sure, yes.
It's not self-managed.
That's something that telephones in the University of Crete have. In order for hackers not to be able to hack your phone conversations, this protocol is applied here.
Okay. Thanks, Lefteri. Yes.
There is any time to leave to refresh ARP registry from IP? If you have a computer that has LAN network and then Wi-Fi, that have actually 2 IPs, but one MAC address. In case that the computer is shut down and we send the package, is any protocol? time or not actually.
It's basically, it used this time to leave field, and basically you use this to cast the information. If this expires, basically then you ask again. If now during this time frame, basically something happens on the other side, basically the, for example, what you said, the other computer is turned off, then the other computer is turned on again. Here actually I don't remember, maybe right. Basically, I will double check this, but I remember that basically you will learn by failure. So if you cannot, if you try to, if you try to if this association is not valid anymore within this time frame, basically. You will learn by failure. You won't be able to send packets. Okay, so let's move on. Okay, now let's see the case that we have to send a packet to a different LAN. So far we have been talking, like we started with a simple example that we are in the same LAN. Assume that we have this topology. We have this LAN on the right and we have another LAN on the left. On the left we have like computer A, and on the right we have computer B. And in the middle we have what we have here. A router, great. Okay. okay, let's say now that A wants to send a packet to B. Okay. So, first question. Assume that this packet is prepared by A. A puts adds the headers we want to the packet, and he writes this to the wire. So, before we cross the router, who can tell me? Let's find the four addresses we have here. We have two IP addresses and two MAC addresses. Okay. What are the destination addresses? What is a destination IP and what is a destination MAC? I'll give you 30 seconds to think about it. And the next question, of course, is what happens here? Do I see more hands? Who knows? Okay, I'll ask you. For the destination address.
The destination IP is computer 3 IP. The hop.
Which one? Tell me the number. Okay. Why is that?
So that we said the MAC address is from hop. So when you set the packet, the packet knows only the next destination.
Okay, let me first say it's correct what you say. Okay. So the destination address is at this point. The IP address will be the IP address of B, and the MAC address will be the MAC address of this interface. Okay? And please keep this in mind. When we are talking about MAC addresses, MAC addresses basically only address something in the same LAN. They only have life within a LAN, within the same local area network. No matter, I mean, if you are talking, you know, to where you are talking and to what is the final destination of the packets, remember that MAC addresses, they have life and meaning within the local area network. And then they, like every time we go through a router, they change. Okay, and now I gave you also the solution for the source addresses in this example. Okay, it's pretty straightforward. Okay, and now, so who wants to take a try on the other side? So what are here the source and destination addresses?
IP addresses remain the same.
Right.
And MAC addresses for the MAC address of write interface of ART. Destination MAC is MAC address.
Great. Okay. Nice. So is this clear? So if we had a third, a second switch here, and a third LAN, what would be the, let's say that this is another router here?
The destination MAC would be that router's first interface.
So would be the router's first interface. Mm-hmm. Okay.
That the MAC address has a meaning inside the local network, or has a meaning until the first router, because maybe the router will be, I don't know, miles away. Will the MAC address remain the same until it finds the first hop, or after a specific on other matrices, we lose the meaning of it?
Yes, I didn't understand very well.
MAC address will be that MAC address until it finds the first hop.
Right.
Okay. You should all remember that MAC addresses are layer 2 entities. So when they cross routers, they get stripped, the packets get stripped of their MAC addresses and get the routers that they pass through their own MAC address. So as Fonda said, is an entity that lives only inside the LAN with the same value because it's layer 2. When you get through the router, it becomes a layer 3 packet, so it gets stripped of its own MAC address.
Okay, so that's about ARP and MAC addresses and IP addresses. Okay. Okay. We're moving on with the recap of the basic some basic elements of computer networks, and of course one of the next basic elements is a switch. Okay, a switch is a layer 2 device that sits in the network and moves packets between between computers attached to that are in the same LAN. So when we are talking about switches, often the Ethernet protocol is used for addressing here, and in modern layer 2 Ethernet links, basically we have star topologies like the one we see here, and for this reason we don't have collisions. Okay, let me ask a question here. I understand that everybody like here in this room should be able to answer what is a switch. So now question for you. Do we have a forwarding table in a switch? Give you 10 seconds to think it. Okay, time is up. So, who says that we have a forwarding table? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Mm-hmm. Who says that we don't have a forwarding table? 1, 2, 3. Okay, and the answer is that we do have a forwarding table, specifically. In switches, the forwarding table is called the switch table. This is the name that we use to how this how we call it. And now the next question is how do we build the switch table? Who remembers the process? Yes?
I think the table at first is empty. And the first step is like the hub's forwarding table. But let's start with the hub, which is a dumb dumb action who sends packets all the time to learn the other interfaces, while the switch sends only one time, only the first time to everyone the packets, so it will learn who will be the for example terminal A, and then when he will want to find terminal A again, won't have to ask everyone in the network because it will be in the table, and that's the.
Do you remember how we call this this process? Self-learning suites. Okay. Why we call it self-learning? Okay. And let's see an example. Assume that we have this topology and A wants to send a packet to A prime. Okay. This is the switch table. The switch table is located in the switch, of course. Okay. So when, sorry. Okay. When this packet is first sent from A to the switch, then the switch will put an entry here and it will say, I saw a packet on interface 1 and this packet has the source IP, the source MAC A. Okay, then I learned from this that A is on interface 1. Then we have again a time to leave. Okay, this is a little bit, sometimes it's arbitrary, the time to leave. Let's assume it's 60 seconds here. Okay, so this is the algorithm I just tell you. When the frame is received at the switch, step one. Okay, we write down the source MAC address and the interface. Now, the table we have is indexed by the destination MAC. Okay, what does this mean, that it is indexed by the destination MAC? Yes?
Yeah.
Right. Precisely. It means, basically, in other words, that when we make queries to the table, we, of course, query for the destination. Okay. We query the destination MAC. Okay. Okay. So if we find an entry in the table for the destination, then if the destination on segment from which frame arrived, so basically this says that the destination is on the link from which the packet arrived, then basically we drop the packet. Otherwise, we forward the frame on the interface that we learned from the switch table. Don't get confused. This is not something too complex. In simple words, it says that when we have a packet, we take the destination MAC, we look up the switch table. The switch table tells us that this MAC is on interface 3. If this packet came from interface 3, and then it tells us to send it back to interface 3. So which is this means something strange happens, or we drop the packet in this case. If it didn't come from interface 3, then everything is fine. We send it to interface 3 and we move on to the next packet. Last case, if there is no entry in the table for this destination, then what do we do? Yes?
Send it all possible interfaces.
Precisely. We flood it. If there is no entry, we flood it. Okay, and then, so, like, this packet goes there, the very first time, Sorry, here the animation does not show up correctly. The very first time that we will get the packet, we will flood it to every interface. In the second step, we will get a reply from the correct computer. So in all the other times, when we get a reply, we will also learn the address of the destination. We will learn A prime. So this will be entered into the switch table at the switch. Okay, and so far we saw the simple case where we have a single switch, and basically the same process generalizes, it works at exactly the same way if we have multiple switches and we have more complex topologies, like here. Okay. So let's take a quick break. I think it's time, and we'll continue with virtual LANs afterwards. Okay, guys, welcome back. We are moving on with the class, and let's see a few more interesting things in the remaining hour. Okay, and let's start with very briefly. Who knows here what is a virtual LAN? You? Okay. Three? Okay, who wants to explain? You? Okay.
Thanks
for the answer. I think it's fantastic. It's very good. Okay. Does someone want to add why do we need virtual LANs?
No. For network management and segmentation, it's required for security purposes.
So I think you are saying the same thing with different words. Okay. Let me also say that basically, so why we need the virtual LANs? Assume that we have, I'll describe that with an example. In some cases, we might have a very big network, for example, in our campus, the computer science department, TETI, I would say, like the materials department. You know, they're and UCNet, they're in the same building. So they could, in principle, be in the same local area network. Let's make this assumption, or like let's imagine this. For like various reasons, we might want to isolate like a physical local area network that is very big, like the one in this example, into smaller local area networks. One way would be to go and plug and plug cables and change the topology and add a router or a bunch of routers so that you have the local area networks you truly want. And this is like what was happening in the past. With virtual local area networks, you get two benefits. First of all, given one local area network, you can build multiple virtual LANs on top of the LAN. And this is useful for isolation or for security or secrecy, because we might not want, for example, the computer science students to use the printers of the secretaries, let's say, or the or to access the ARP requests of the secretaries, or even the DNS requests, this is useful for isolation. You make the size of the LAN smaller, so you have fewer users, and this makes it more less congested. And also for privacy, secrecy, because if you are in the same LAN, you could in principle spoof. Even if this is a star topology, in some cases you might see, for example, some DNS requests that other people are doing, especially if these are broadcasting, this reveals some private information. Virtual LANs provide the ability to segment a physical LAN into virtual LANs. Besides the other two reasons, another benefit to them is that we can more easily manage them. Can you give me an example of better management?
And we have local LAN, I want to be in the same LAN, we need to be easy in local LAN.
Right. Okay. So this could be one department. If one moves from one office to another office, you can keep him in the same virtual LAN regarding of the office. Okay. Virtual LANs are used, as an aside, they are used today a lot in data centers. Extensively in data centers, and they are actually, it's especially the last few years, they're somewhat a topic of interest, because if you have data centers with hundreds of thousands of servers and hundreds of thousands of users, the traditional VLAN technologies couldn't support so many different VLANs, like order of hundreds of thousands, and this has caused the last few years the engineers to go and revisit the virtual LAN technologies and see and for the specific use case of data centers and see how we can make VLAN technologies support more users. How do we say users in a data center context? The term that is used? We could call them Nikarites. Tenants. Tenants, that would be tenants. Who said that? Tenants, right. So tenants is basically the right keyword here. Okay, I won't tell you much more about VLANs. Just maybe remember this picture. So this is a traditional switch with a VLAN technology. We can assign the ports of a switch to different virtual LANs. This has essentially the effect that this switch operates as two different switches. Okay, if we get a packet here, we will broadcast it here. We will build a switch table that is only for these ports. This is a port-based VLAN, where we assign different ports to different VLANs. Okay, this is one way to do VLANs. But besides this, there exist many different VLAN technologies. It's beyond the, basically, the interest of this lecture and of this course. But we could have like several lectures on just VLAN technologies. But to keep it simple, like keep this image in your mind. And also this thing here. So when we have two like VLANs, as it was stated earlier on, now if we want port 8 to communicate with port 10, this would now happen exactly as if we had two separate physical LANs. It has to go through a router. And it's a bit strange, but here, if this guy wants to talk to this guy, it needs to go through the router when they're configured with a virtual LAN. Also, VLANs can span multiple switches. It's not that we have one switch and we split it in 2, 3, 4. We could have two switches, or 100 switches, and we had some horizontal VLANs that span all the 100 switches, and this is how data centers work. Basically, this is what happens in data centers. Right.
That's actually there's a lot of traffic on the switch to proceed. Have a lot of computers that communicate with another switch.
Yes.
Which is how another switch, so they do a lot of jobs.
Yes.
Good to have something like this, or is better to
As with everything, like you have some advantages and some disadvantages. And right here, if you have a router, this could mean some extra packets that go up and down. Okay, guys, we switch to the next topic. Okay, we go to network layer, and the first thing I want to cover is not okay. And I know you should, like, how many of you know what is a NAT? How many of you don't know? Okay. Who wants okay, I will explain, but I will ask the next question. Okay, a NAT basically is a technology that stands for Network Address Translation, and that allows basically basically use one IP address for multiple devices, multiple computers that sit behind the network address translator. This is an example of this case. We have here the device that is the NAT. The NAT is using one IP address. And behind this, we have, like, we can have as many as we like. This is not entirely true, but many. Computers that share this IP address. Okay, so first question. Who can tell me the benefits of NATs? Some of the benefits of NATs. Okay, yes.
Actually, NAT can hide the local network from outside.
What is the benefit?
Benefit of it, if you have a company that you don't want to compromise how much machine you have in a local network. How big you are.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so you mean it's for security? Great. Okay, I think you were second.
Proper usage of IPv4s for economy.
For economy, right. So, economy of IPv4 addresses, security. To clarify, because here, besides behind the NAT, we use what we all know as private IP addresses, right? And we can use reuse private IP addresses in different places. I mean, most of you at your homes probably use the same IP addresses because your router is also a NAT. So this way, we do better conservation of the IPs. Yes?
You can make local changes to your without having to modify your ISP.
Correct. I think there is one more.
Somebody to come in from outside to the PC inside the local network because that dynamically gives port numbers.
This is true, yes, this is also correct, but it basically falls under the umbrella of better security. And one more, according to the, to the book at least, it's basically that we can change internet service providers without having to change the IP addresses of our organization. which is a bit similar with the other one that like your colleague said.
Great, okay. Let me say that I, like in this lecture, I go over these things again. As in the programming assignments, we will have to implement these functions, and we will see a specific, like how ARC works. We'll have to implement that, and so on. Okay, now who wants to take a try to explain how NAT operates with an example? And let me see if I have a slide here. Yeah, but I'm not going to show you. Basically, we will use... okay, we'll use this. Okay.
So let's say that one computer from the local network, let's call this computer A, wants to send a packet to another computer in another network, let's call this B. So the source IP will be 10.0.0.1, for example, and it will travel through the router where there is a NAT table, I think is the name. So this packet will have a mapping with the from the physical IP and the virtual IP, I think, and it will be 10.0.0.1.
It's the public and the private IP.
The public and the private. Okay, that will be the mapping, and when the packet will be sent, it will reach to another NAT. So this. This packet will have a destination IP, which will not be the local network's IP, the private IP, but it will be the public IP. So in that NAT table, there will also be a mapping, which will send the packet to the specific computer and not to all the local network. That's the case.
Okay, I think it sounds 60% correct. I didn't follow some parts. I missed you in a couple of parts, but it sounds along the lines.
Okay, so let's do this here in more detail. Okay, let's do this example. So we have step one. Okay, we have our PC in our home that wants to go at Google. Okay, we send a packet. This is the packet, and this is the source IP, and this is the destination IP. Okay, and we also have a source port and a destination port. So this reaches the router, the NAT, okay? And usually the NAT is implemented in a router, in the first router. At the NAT now, we have a NAT table. The NAT table is basically what you see over here. It's, again, a mapping. In computer, remember, we have many protocols that implement a mapping. You know, ARP implements a mapping, DNS implements a mapping. Okay, I close the parenthesis. This makes also a mapping. On the one side of the table, we have this is the private part, and this is the public part. This is the internet. On the one side, we have the private IP address and the original port number of the packet. And this is on the right side here. And on the other side, we have the public IP address and
We have one port number that we will assign. And here is comes a trick. Okay. And there is a trick here that basically now we have created a new identifier for the socket sitting in that computer. The new identifier is basically this tuple. And this is the public identifier. This is what the world will see for us. The world will think that it's talking to this socket. Yes. So this is a combination of a port and an IP address. And now, what we are doing here, and this is the trick, by using one IP address but different port numbers, we can address in reality different IP addresses sitting behind the NAT. Okay, all these guys will be mapped to the same IP address, but here to a different port number. Okay, so who can give me a limitation? Who can, like, that basically comes directly? Yes?
Actually, we have limitations of port numbers.
Tell me more.
So we don't have, we cannot have a lot of connections from a lot of PCs inside of our network that come outside of our local network.
How many connections can we have? Someone else remembers? 16,536. So this is the, so a port number is 8 bits. Remember, it's 8 bits. 2 to no, it's 16 bits, right? Yeah, 16 bits. So this means, okay, it's, I'm wrong. It's 60,000, basically. Approximately 60,000 simultaneous connections. Okay. So now we are at step two. So we have passed here the switch. Like, who can tell me what happens at step three? Yes?
The packet comes to a router and use the NAT translation table to redirect in the correct computer, correct terminal.
And does it change anything in the packet?
Yes, the destination IP address, because it meets and the port, because it meets.
Nice, the correct. Okay, so when this packet comes back, the NAT will use the NAT table and will change the destination IP and the destination port to the real IP and the real port. Okay, and this happens for every packet that goes out and for every packet that comes in. Okay, it's a lot of work for the NAT. Okay. Now, yeah. Let's change topic again and move a little bit to the routing and basically recall how routing works. And routing is very important in the software-defined networks because software-defined networks are about routing and switching. Okay. Okay, remember that in a router we have a forwarding table and we have on top basically a set of algorithms, let's say, that populate this forwarding table. Okay, who can tell me
the key differences between a router and a switch.
No one knows the...
Come on, some key differences between a router and a switch. Come on, someone... Yes.
Who's there?
Fantastic, yes. And another, so another
for
one.
Example, a router does not do much learning. Basically, what they do through practice.
Okay. You covered the two things I wanted to hear. The first one, that of course the one is a layer 2 device, the other is a layer 3 device. And the other one, the touchstone, is that in a switch, it's a self-learning device. A router doesn't do self-learning. It has a forwarding table that is, this is computed and populated by routing algorithms and routing protocols. You wanted to say something?
Yes. Switch is a plug and play device, but the router needs a little bit of configuration to play.
Correct. Very correct. I mean, that's better than the book. Okay. Great. Let me jump into one topic I want to remind you. Okay, here of course we can make a graph abstraction. Remember that we can make a graph abstraction of a network. And let's move to the topic of hierarchical routing. Okay, and today, you might remember from an older lecture, routing in the internet is hierarchical. What does this mean? This means that it works on two levels. It works on the level of a domain, let's say an internet service provider, it works at the same time at the level of the global internet of communication, let's say, between internet service providers. Now, but before explaining the operation, I wanted first to remind us why this happens. Why is it structured like that in two levels, hierarchically? Okay, so the answer is over there. I will hide this and see who remembers. I need two reasons. It's for two reasons. The question again is that why is routing hierarchical?
Yes.
Fantastic.
So you named the first region. This is what you said. It's also referred as scalability. It's for scalability reasons. We need a smaller. We want to have a small routing table in an internet with millions or billions of destinations, where we can have fast lookups. Okay. Now the second reason, another reason we have it hierarchical. Maybe. Right. Okay. Yes. I would also maybe put this under the umbrella of scalability. Yanni?
Maybe if we didn't have the routing hierarchy, the backbone routers would overload.
Hey, guy, all this is called scalability. It's very simple, actually, the other reason. It's not technical. Managerial.
If something fails, we can reach it by another destination, but within the port, the IP that we use, I have a machine here, and I want to access a machine somewhere else.
I just know where to send the packet in one hop distance. So if something fails after, I can reach by another destination.
No, sorry. That's not what I'm looking for. So I'll give you the answer. I mean, the second reason, it's simply for autonomy. Not we, basically, the guys that designed the internet decided internet service providers should have the autonomy to control routing within their basically coverage the way they want. And this should be independently of what their neighbors are doing. How did we say we call these internet service providers in the last lecture?
Autonomous systems. Right, this is why they are called autonomous systems.
Okay. So, scale, it's the one keyword, and administrative autonomy, it's the other keyword. For these two reasons, the routing was designed to be hierarchical. Okay. So, as you know, the internet is composed of autonomous systems. Autonomous systems are internet service providers and so on. And basically, within a router, we have two processes. We have a process that is called intra-IS routing that basically computes paths for destinations within the autonomous system. And then we have a second process that computes paths for the entire internet, for the global internet. This second process runs only on the border routers of the network, while the first process runs on every router. This means that in the border routers we have both processes running, and both processes concurrently they compute the forwarding table. All good? Okay. Okay. So basically it's 4 o'clock, and I know that when 4 o'clock comes you all have a bell that rings, a virtual bell. Okay, I won't keep you much more. So basically, let me add one more sentence here. For the two processes I was saying before, we have different protocols. Okay, and I think this is important, although it's at the end of the class, please pay attention. These protocols operate in a router. They are distributed protocols. They exchange advertisements with other routers about the list of destinations, and they coordinate to compute the forwarding table. Here are some examples of protocols for the intra-domain part within autonomous systems, so RIP, OSPF, and IGRP. These protocols are complicated, they are not simple protocols. They have lots of depth, and we could discuss them for hours. Okay, so these are examples of IGP protocols, interior gateway protocols. And then for the exterior part, we have one protocol that is used in the entire internet, that is the BGP, the Border Gateway Protocol. And BGP is also complicated. Some people think it's the most complicated protocol in the internet, which is could be, I think it's likely true. Okay, to sum up, basically, this is the agenda. Today we did a quick recap of some basic entities. You will need to know very well what is ARC, how ARC works, how MAC address works, how IP address works, how switching works. It's good to know some information about these routing protocols, although we won't see them in detail. And of course, NATs, you need to know how they work in detail. Okay, so thank you, and have a good afternoon.